Good morning and welcome. What a beautiful morning we have today. It's starting to creep up in the temperature though, but its sunshine is beautiful. Do we have any announcements this morning? No announcements? Tara, do you have everybody you need? Yes. Tara.
Vacation Bible School. We shortened it to 3 days this year so that we could get more volunteers and not have them tired by the end of it. There is going to be sign up things at the back of the church where for donations for the snacks and the food, and I still need volunteers to help lead some of the groups to kind of school the children around. And then if you know anybody, any kids, there is online registry or we have paper if that's easier, so just let us know.
Okay, right. So you might want to think of Tara when I'm giving the message later. You'll understand when we get there. Okay, any other announcements? No? Okay, Nancy, can you lead us in? Thank you, that was beautiful. Let's open this morning with a call to worship. Therefore, let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, and thus let us offer to God acceptable worship with reverence and awe. Now bow with me, please. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you today on this beautiful day to worship you, to fellowship with one another, and to learn the message that you have for us today. I ask, Lord, that the words that they're about to receive be words that come from you, Father, and not from me. This I ask in your Son Jesus' name. Amen. Now, if you all stand for prayer, we have to do a little bit different. Stand for song. You will need your hymnals this week. The first song is For the Healing of the Nations, hymnal 428. Please stand. Please turn in your hymnals to page 393, Spirit of the Living God. Be seated. Okay, we've come to that time for joys and concerns. Do we have any? I do have one from PV, actually two. Marsha's doing much better. For those who know Marsha Gallant, she had surgery. She is doing better, and thank you for her prayers. And we'd like to lift up the Collins family who was in that horrendous explosion the other day. Does anybody else? Dean?
Mary Ellen Jacobs, which is Pastor Mike's mom, asked for travel mercies for him on his way home. Okay. And prayers for the family of Brenda Ensley. Chuck comes out, and he's one of our clowns that comes for Fall Festival. She passed away this week.
With all the shootings we've been having, all the school shootings and that, I know I've had people talk to me and ask me, say, well, you know, why doesn't God do something? If you remember, about 30 years ago, we took God out of school. He's not there anymore.
Anyone else have anything? Slow morning. That's not a bad thing. Okay, if there's nothing else, let's turn to our hymnals to 534, Be Still My Soul.
Thank you.
Lord, we come together again as we have gathered here today to worship you with a few concerns on our hearts, Father. We thank you for always being there with us, and now we ask that you be with others, to be with the farmers who are just about done planting their fields. We ask that you send the gentle rains in order for their crops to grow. And Lord, we lift up Pastor Mike in his travels and ask that your angels surround him and bring him safely back. And Lord, we lift up the Inslee family as they have now lost a loved one. Lord, we ask that you just put your loving, comforting arms around them, strengthen them, and be with them through this time. And be with the Collins family also, Father, as they deal with the loss of their loved ones. And we ask, Father, that you just let your presence be known so that they can feel that comfort. Lord, we lift up our country and the turmoil they're in. And we ask, Father, that you open their eyes and have them ask you to come back into their hearts. Help heal the country, Father, as only you can. And those of us here have come to you, Father, and we are going to join in prayer with the prayer your Son gave us, together as one. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now, if the children want to come up front.
Good morning. This is kind of nice to see this many kids here today. It's nice outside, too. We even had our Sunday school outside, didn't we, Kennedy? Yeah. All right. Well, Kennedy has a Bible verse she's going to read first, and then I'm going to tell them a little story.
Matthew 4:19, and he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fishermen."
Okay. So, have any of you ever been fishing before? Yeah? Did you catch any fish? Or you just have fish tails? Your dad has lots of those, Grayson. Does anybody know what this thing is?
Fish.
A fishing net. Do you remember a story from the Bible that you guys have heard a few times where Peter and his friends were fishing out in a boat and they weren't catching any fish at all? And then they saw a man on the shore, and he told him to throw the net over the right side of the boat, and all of a sudden the net was so full of fish they couldn't even pull it in the boat. And who was that man?
Jesus.
Good job. So, did they doubt him?
No.
Yeah, a little, but they did it anyways, right? And then they had the fish for breakfast. So, do you want to try to catch a fish out of the bucket? No fish? No?
Yeah.
All right. Now we're going to let you try to fish.
Yeah.
Yeah. Go ahead. Try to fish.
I'm trying to get a fish.
It's hard to get a fish when there's only one fish, isn't it?
I think I got a fish.
Okay. Now.
That
is? Now put that fish back in and try to get another fish. Is it easier to catch a fish when there's more fish? You did. All right. So Grayson's got a Bible verse he's going to read.
Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a dragnet cast into the sea and gathering fish of every land. Matthew 3:13-14.
Okay, so I have a job for you guys. You knew that there was a trick to this, right? So we have a vacation Bible school coming up at the beginning of August, and we need you guys to be fishermen for God and catch some of your friends, your cousins, your neighbors, and drag them to Bible school with you like the fish in a net, okay? So we're going to say a little prayer, and then before you leave, I've got some goldfish for you. All right. Dear Lord, thank you for bringing the kids here today and for the beautiful weather. Thank you for giving them the opportunity to know God and be able to be the fisher of men. Please give them a safe week, a fun week, and have them find some people to bring to Bible school. Amen.
This morning I'll be reading Acts chapter 1, verses 21 through 26. So one of the men who have accompanied us during all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day when he was taken up from us, one of these must become a witness with us to his resurrection. So they proposed to Joseph, called Barsabbas, who was also known as Justus, and Matthias. Then they prayed and said, Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which one of these two you have chosen to take the place in this ministry and apostleship from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place. And they cast lots for them, and the lot fell on Matthias, and he was added to the 11 apostles.
Thank you, Sarah. And thank you, Miss Tara, for that lesson. Today I want to share with you about a man named Matthias. Does anybody know who Matthias is? To be honest, I didn't know either. We'll get to that. We know that Jesus began his ministry handpicking his apostles. There were 12 from various backgrounds. Now, apostle in Greek means, the Greek word means literally one who is sent. These are the men also were known as disciples. Those chosen were not famous and not necessarily from well-respected occupations. In fact, some were simply not liked because of their occupation. And to this day, who of us likes the tax man? I think IRS is a pain in the butt. When talking about the apostles, we automatically think of the 12 men that were closest to Jesus. Now, while there were the inner circle with Jesus, there were 70 plus more that were known as the outer circle that also followed Jesus everywhere. These men and women began to gather around Jesus all along through his years of ministry and were just as excited to follow him as the original 12. Some went back as early as the beginning with those 12, back to the time of John baptizing Jesus. Now, someone had sometimes used the word apostle and other times used the word disciple, and someone asked me, what's the difference? The simplest explanation I could come up with is that apostles are disciples, but not all disciples are apostles. Apostles are the ones in the inner circle who literally were the ones sent out to start the new churches. A disciple, according to the dictionary, is one who accepts and assists in the doctrines of another. In other words, those who are witnesses for Jesus. And that, ladies and gentlemen, are you and me. We are all disciples. Now, Jesus moved around the countryside preaching and teaching for 3 years. Doesn't sound like a whole lot of time, but what he accomplished in that time changed how we live our lives today. Well, let's fast forward from the handpicking of his apostles to the night of the Last Supper. That night, Jesus around the table tells his most trusted disciples that one of them will do the unthinkable. One of them would be a traitor. And with that, Jesus' final journey of his ministry here on earth began. I want you to think about that. If you've been together, we've been together for a lot of years. We trust each other, and we think we have each other's back. How do you think those disciples felt? How would you have felt knowing if Pastor Mike stood up here and said, one of you is going to betray me? You'd probably thought he lost his mind, and you would deny it. There'd be a lot of shock. But the Bible tells us that's exactly what happened between the apostles and Jesus. They lived close together and trusted one another. They were family. Then Judas became a betrayer. He turns Jesus over to the authorities for a few simple silver coins, all for greed. He then learned really quick that money does not buy everything. It does not buy happiness. In fact, it cost him everything he had. He had not only lost his best friend and teacher, but he brought harm to that most important person in his life. He no longer had any friends, and he had nowhere to go. No amount of money could give him back the multitude of things he had lost. In the end, Judas decided life was not worth living, and he hung himself. At this point in the Bible, we are at 11 apostles. Peter believed that a verse in Psalm applied to their situation. Psalm 109, verse 8. May his place be deserted, let there be no one to dwell in it, and may another take his place. Peter believed that the area where Judas' hanging happened should be left empty, no one should live there, but now a replacement was needed to go among them. So after Jesus ascended into heaven, the first act of business was to replace Judas. It was important to have 12 apostles. We know there are no random numbers in the Bible. The numbers in the Bible all have meaning. In this instance, 12 was needed in order to represent the 12 tribes of Israel. The question now is, how is this to be accomplished? After all, Jesus handpicked the original 12. And he's already in heaven, so that personal invitation isn't going to come. Don't get me wrong, God guided the entire process, but it would be different. Both in the Old Testament and New Testament, when making a choice where you have options, the act of casting lots would be the method of choosing, much like rolling the dice. It tells us in Proverbs 18:18, casting the lots settles disputes and keeps opponents apart. So the disciples gathered and began with prayer. Two men were chosen from those who had been in the outer circle since the beginning, Barabbas and Matthias. Their lots were cast, the dice was rolled. Prayer had been that God would check the hearts of these two men and let the dice land with who God had chosen. It had landed with Matthias, the disciple to complete the 12 again. So just who is this Matthias who was Judas's replacement? To be honest, when I first learned there was a Matthias, I was like, who is he? I've read my Bible and reread it, but Matthias had never left an impression on me. This leads to a reason why we keep reading and rereading our Bible. God is always showing us something new. This man named Matthias is only mentioned twice in the Bible, both times in Acts that was just read in the scripture today, which means there's not a whole lot of information. We do know that in the early church, there was believed to be a gospel of Matthias. Many others had written about it, but the gospel of Matthias was never able to be authenticated. We only know the possibilities of these such writings. We can be sure that because of being an apostle, we know that he was charged with preaching, help spreading it, and starting new churches throughout the world. From here, the life of Matthias has become more of a legend than of concrete evidence in history. Much of what we know about Matthias comes from the history handed down through church, most notably the Catholic Church. The Catholic Church has canonized all the original 12 disciples. Sorry, not the original 12, the 12 after Matthias joined. And Matthias was canonized as the patron saint of alcoholics. So we know that to be true. He may not have been the most popular, the first picked, but Matthias loved Jesus and was faithful. Even with the information that can be provided by the Catholic Church, not all theologians agree 100%. All, however, are in agreement about the name Matthias as a form of the name Matthew, and it means a gift of God. He was charged with preaching the gospel and helping others to do the same. That part is undeniable, because all the apostles were instructed to do that. There are different theories as to where he was sent and how he died. The most popular theory is that he was sent to preach among the cannibals. Not sure I would take on that job. Can you imagine what happens if they don't like what you got to say? As for the death, some say he eventually was stoned by the cannibals, and yet others have said he was stoned to death by the Jews and then beheaded. Whatever end he came to, the agreement was that he was martyred, for he was sharing what he believed and was teaching others of Jesus, telling whoever would listen about their salvation. We may not know the accomplishments of Matthias' life, but we can be assured he was called by God, although selected in a different way. God didn't care if Matthias was homecoming king or the most popular man in town. What God cared about was what was in Matthias' heart and his willingness to follow Jesus' lead. Matthias was not well known to us. His work is not published for all of us to see. Nevertheless, his work was important, can even be considered vital for the growth of the church. He planted seeds. He cared for those seeds so that God would have a harvest to reap. Here in our little corner of the world, I ask, are you a Matthias? 7 years ago, I was sitting in the pew on Sunday mornings. In my mind, I thought you had to be someone special, someone really smart to sit up here. And that certainly wasn't me. I even thought, as I've told many of you, that Pastor Mark had lost his mind at that point. But I learned through my journey that there is no small task, or even a task that seems unsurmountable, when you're doing the work for God. And he doesn't want us all doing the same thing. God has a plan for each of us. We all have talents that will honor him. And that's the whole thing, to honor our God. We have our ladies who make the blankets for the people that are in the hospital or seriously ill. That is helping. That is planting seeds. We have Nancy and Lana who play the music. We have Sunday school teachers. We volunteer to help in our community. I could go on and on. When we see a need, we need to act to honor God. When we are helping others, we should not expect anything in return, because what we are doing are planting seeds. When God calls us, we need to listen and not question. God does not call the equipped, but will equip those he calls. Just like Matthias, years from now, people will not remember our names or exactly what it was we did or how we died. But they will remember that there were God's disciples serving him, loving him, and following him. We are disciples today, here and now, living for him and wanting to teach others of the wonderful love our God has for us. We want to share with others the place that he is building for us to be with him forever. By doing all this, leads to others who come after us to continue building God's kingdom. The kingdom will not grow without the Matthiases of the world. In Matthias' story, there are two main parts I want you to take with you. It's not about popularity. It's about your faithfulness. The truth is, God doesn't care how popular you are. He's looking at our hearts. And two, when it comes to our calling, there is no such thing as a small task. If he calls you to something, do it. And where he leads you, he will guide you. The Bible told us nothing about Matthias or what he did after he became the 12th apostle. Never mentioned him again. The Bible doesn't tell us how Matthias went about what he was doing. Just the call, God called him to do it. Friends, if God is calling you to do something, it means it's significant and it's extremely important. And it will bring us closer to Jesus. In John 15, verse 16, Jesus said, "You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last." So I ask again, are you a Matthias in our little corner of the world? I challenge you to remember that God has chosen each of us to help build the kingdom and bring others to Christ. Be a Matthias in our little corner of the world. Share the joy and love. Plant the seeds and answer yes when God calls. Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, I lift everyone up who is listening to this message and ask you to guide them in their call to serve you. I ask that you be with them and equip them and help them not be afraid to say yes. Lord, be with all these people as they leave here today and go through this week. Help them to be the Matthias of our corner of the world and bring them safely back next week. In your son Jesus' name, amen. So now, if you can join me for the closing hymn, page 664, sent forth by God's blessing, please stand if you're able. Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon thee and be gracious to thee. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. Now go, be a Matthias, and have a good week.